Greetings, Read My Mind Radio family. A very happy 2022 to you and yours. My name is Thomas Reed. I'm the host and producer of this podcast, which brings you compelling people impacted by all degrees of blindness and disability. As I mentioned in the final episode of 2021, the plan for 2022 is to return sometime in the first quarter. Well, I still have another month. The official start of the first season will be the second Tuesday in March, March 8th. However, as I also said, I thought there was a chance that I'd add an episode or two to the feed that doesn't necessarily fall into the seasonal themes this year. I'll share more on the themes for this year later, but for now, I want to focus on this month, February, Black History Month. Over the years, I recall discussions questioning whether or not we need Black History Month. The argument was that Black history should just be a part of the curriculum. I agree, it should be. But it's pretty obvious today that some want to fight against that.
Critical race theory.
Critical race theory.
Critical race theory.
There are thousands of parents all over the U.S. of all races who have been speaking out against CRT, and rightfully so. These are my babies, not yours. If you are embarrassed or ashamed of your skin color, that's your issue, not mine nor my children.
We do not want our children to be taught that America is systemically racist.
Republican politicians have been hyping critical race theory as a threat to the impressionable minds of America's children.
Critical race theory says every white person is a racist. Critical race theory says America is fundamentally racist and irredeemably racist.
Critical race theory is an academic framework that says racial inequality is perpetuated by the racism embedded in America's laws, not by individual bigotry.
Critical race theory is not being taught in schools. It is a theory, it is a lens by which to view history and the way that law and race kind of overlaps and connects in society. Can it influence the way that some teachers teach? Yeah, but that's a good thing, right? Because race and racism is literally the building blocks of this country. So how can you not talk about it?
Now more than ever, Black History Month seems even more important, especially if we want to see Black in the future. February has always been the time of year unlike any other where I would have access to programming, most often on PBS, that would focus on the Black experience. It's the independent producers who bring stories about the lesser-known activists, stories of resistance that offer a different perspective. Stories that challenge what we get from the mainstream productions. Often, that's the whitewashing of history, corporate co-opting, or propaganda to convince the country that we're making racial progress. We're shown scenes from the civil rights movements where police are releasing dogs and using high-powered fire hoses, so-called riots and destructions of Black communities. That was back then, we're told. Black people are encouraged to keep our eyes on the prize, focus on our strengths, determination, resilience. There's very little conversation about the generational trauma, little discussion about the responsibility of white people to reconcile and own up to the crimes against humanity. I've come to realize that I have to be aware of the content I consume. There's way too many things that leave me wondering, when will there be a story where we win? A story where we can just live our lives without worrying about discrimination, racism, murder. I guess an optimist would say our existence today, our survival, the fact that our creativity and our art leads the world is an example of a win. Sometimes, I just need more. Today, I'll bring you that. It's a Black History mashup where I borrow from two real-world figures from the past, merging a bit of fact with fiction in order to give you an example of that kind of win that I'm talking about. It's probably way more simpler than some think. Y'all with me? Let's go, fam.
Yes, I rule and I rule and I try to hold my down. Yes, I rule and I rule and I try to hold my down.
Meet Uncle Zeke. He was born in South Carolina, but grew up in Goldsboro, North Carolina. His father was a sharecropper. I hate that name. It implies there was some form of cooperation happening when there really wasn't. The way it worked, the landowner, or the former enslavers, offered a part of their land to be farmed by the sharecropper. The landowner would provide other things as well, including housing, tools, seed, or working animals. Things like food and other supplies were exchanged on credit. The sharecropper would pay the owner a share of the crop at the end of the season, typically a half to two-thirds. If there was any cash left over, the cropper kept it. But if his share came to less than he owed, he remained in debt. Knowing the sharecropper could do little to refute any disagreement, the practice kept sharecroppers bound to the landowners. Slavery without the chains. Diabolical. There wasn't much in the way of educational opportunities for Uncle Zeke. School for him stopped at 11, and he began working the fields full-time. In 1942, at 23 years old, Uncle Zeke saw a chance to improve his future. He enlisted in the Army.
Men like these are not to be stopped. No individual, no evasive words or deeds, no group action or selfish interests will be allowed to impede their growing strength, effectiveness, and safety. For it is they who are sacrificing every advantage of civilian life. They who hold the torch of freedom closest.
Serving as a longshoreman, Uncle Zeke earned a battle star for unloading ships under enemy fire in New Guinea. He was promoted to sergeant. After being honorably discharged from the service in 1946, Uncle Zeke headed back home to North Carolina. While traveling via Greyhound, at a rest stop just outside Augusta, Zeke asked the bus driver if there was time for him to use a restroom. The driver cursed at him, and the two got into an argument. Boy, get back in your seat. Not that it should make a difference, but Uncle Zeke was traveling in his United States Army uniform. He spent 4 years fighting to protect democracy around the world. At least, that's the propaganda often repeated.
We know that we cannot save freedom in our own midst, in our own land, if all around us, our neighbor nations, have lost their freedom.
Talk to me like I'm talking to you, Uncle Zeke insisted. I'm a man just like you. The encounter ended without any incident. However, unknown to Uncle Zeke, at the next stop in the small South Carolina town of Batesburg, the driver called on the local sheriff. The driver claimed Uncle Zeke was being disorderly. Uncle Zeke was ordered off the bus by the town sheriff. The sheriff and his men began surrounding Zeke, who glimpsed a familiar face in his peripheral. He then heard a voice that immediately gave him a sense of comfort.
You boys are going to want to leave that man, that soldier, alone.
Uncle Zeke didn't take his eyes off the sheriff. He watched as the sheriff and his deputies turned their attention to that booming voice. It was his friend, a fellow veteran, Big Rob. Discharged just a few months earlier, Robert Williams, a childhood friend of Zeke, wanted to assure his old friend made it home safely. His own encounter led him to understand that what he and many other black soldiers thought their lives would be like upon returning home as decorated veterans was just wishful thinking. Arriving back home in North Carolina after a long bus ride, Big Rob stopped at a convenience store to get something to drink. As he enters the store, his greeting felt familiar. What you want, boy?
Boy,
he thought.
I don't think he's talking to me.
Quickly, looking around the store, noticing the two were alone, Rob just went about his business of gathering a few things he wanted to purchase. He walked up to the counter, nodded at the white clerk, and paid. He even told the clerk to keep the change.
I'm just happy to be home.
As he exited the store, the clerk timidly told Robert to remember he's back home now. Rob was fully aware that the only reason there wasn't an incident is the clerk was by himself. If there had been another white person in that store with him, things would have been different. Soon after, Rob quickly learned of thousands of black veterans who were beaten and or lynched, something so many thought wouldn't happen to them after serving in the country's military. When he heard his old friend Zeke was coming home, he wanted to surprise him. At least, that's what he told Zeke. Truth is, he always worried about his friend. Zeke was never the type to not say what was on his mind. He knew Zeke could handle himself in a fair fight, but black men don't get fair fights with white men in Jim Crow South.
You heard me, Sheriff. Let that man be, and we'll be out of your town.
We? The sheriff chuckled. This boy is staying here, and if you do leave here, I don't see anyone else with you. It came from behind him. A car and four black soldiers, each holding shotguns, pointing in the sheriff's direction. This was followed by more whistles, all in different locations. The sheriff immediately realized Rob wasn't alone. The police were surrounded by 20-plus armed black men, all veterans in uniform. Ever since his experience and learning about what was happening to his returning brothers, Big Rob decided to put together his own welcoming committee. Zeke never got word that Rob was going to meet him in Georgia, and they missed each other by only a few minutes. Rob decided to follow the bus and realized there was a problem when he saw the driver exit and then the police arrive on the scene. The team, known as the Black Armed Guard, always alert and trained for this sort of thing, went into formation.
We don't want no problems, Sheriff. We just want to take our brother there and make sure he makes it home to his family. I'm sure you know what that feels like, wanting to make it home safely.
The sheriff slowly looks around. That's when he notices the driver of the car about 20 feet to the side of Big Rob. Mabel, Big Rob's wife, was expertly pointing her rifle at the sheriff. He knows he's outnumbered, and these soldiers won't hesitate to use their weapons. Defeat plastered all over his face, the sheriff looks at Uncle Zeke and motions for him to go. Zeke calmly walks over to Rob, who nods towards another long gun at his side. Zeke picks it up, and the two slowly back up and get into the car. All the while, Mabel keeps her gun pointed at the sheriff. It's only when the two are safely in the car with their guns pointed at the sheriff that Mabel starts the engine. After checking her hair in the rearview mirror.
Now please, don't attempt to follow us. We're headed out of your town. I travel with more than you see in front of you, so please, don't try anything. We just want everyone to make it home safely tonight. And I do mean everyone.
With that said, Mabel, Big Rob, Uncle Zeke, and the rest of the brothers caravan out of town without incident. That's a win. While some of the details in this story are true, unfortunately, it never actually went this way. More on what really happened after this.
Who listens to radio?
Are you socially responsible?
I don't even know what that means.
No one knows what it means, but it's provocative.
A great way to stay informed and help spread the word about Read My Mind Radio is social media. Read My Mind Radio is on Facebook and Instagram at Read My Mind Radio. We're in the midst of a social media giveaway. It began in January on Facebook. All you had to do was to like the post announcing the giveaway, and you'd be automatically entered. Some of y'all didn't fully follow the directions and liked the page instead of just liking the post. But that's cool. I appreciate you liking the page. We decided to include everyone who liked the page plus those who liked the post in this giveaway. And now we're going to announce the winner for January's Facebook giveaway. To help me out, I'm going to ask Marlette to come in and help.
Marlette! Can you come and help? Let's do the giveaway!
I told her we was going to do the giveaway.
Hello? Can you help me with the giveaway?
Yes.
All right, so ladies and gentlemen, we're here with Marlette. Marlette, say hi to the people.
Hello.
What is that?
Sorry.
Are you serious? The person responsible for our social media is Annie. She's a friend of the family who decided she wanted to help Read My Mind Radio get a little bit more exposure. I appreciate that, Annie. But Annie can't be here today. She's a little under the weather. It's raining right now. But Annie, the sun will come out tomorrow. Sorry. How many times has she probably heard that in her life? I hope it wasn't a hard knock life.
You're so stupid.
Okay, the winner of this year's Facebook giveaway will get...
They're going to get a Read My Mind Radio mug.
So here we go. You ready, Mola? Shake it up. And the winner is
Justin Romack.
Hey, okay, cool. Yeah. Justin Romack, we will be getting in contact with you to get your address and send you your very own Read My Mind Radio mug, coffee mug. But you can put whatever you want in there, coffee, tea,
adult beverages, water, pens. You know how people put pens in mugs? Put it someplace where people can see it. If you have an office, put it in your office. If you're either?
No.
Thank you for supporting Read My Mind Radio.
Thank you.
So the next giveaway will be on what social media platform?
Instagram.
And so all people would have to do is to
follow, like, share, and comment on it.
All right, y'all, you got some work to do. And that's for
all
the...
All you have to do is say hello. Hi.
Yeah, that's true. That could be a comment. Mm-hmm. So what we want you to do is do what she just said. And you have until February 28th. And then again, we'll reveal the winner in March. And then in March, the giveaway will be on
Twitter.
Thank you, Marla.
You're welcome.
Bye. I'll probably edit all of that out. You can find Read My Mind Radio wherever you get your podcast. That's the perfect place to follow or subscribe so you don't miss an episode. Tell a friend to do the same. Let them also know that we have transcripts and more at readmymind.com. Just make sure you tell them. That's R to the E. I.
D, D, and that's me in the place to be.
Like my last name. Now, back to the episode. Uncle Zeke, Isaac Woodard. He and Big Rob, Robert Williams, while they both grew up in North Carolina, to my knowledge, they didn't know one another. Robert F. Williams was drafted into the Marines in 1944 and served a year and a half. When he returned home, he joined the local chapter of the NAACP and soon became president. His chapter worked to integrate the public library. After that success in 1957, Williams also led efforts to integrate the public swimming pools. The NAACP members organized peaceful demonstrations, but those in opposition fired guns at them. In a town of about 12,000 people, it was estimated that 7,500 belonged to the Klan.
That's the Ku Klux Klan, not the Wu-Tang.
Williams started a local rifle club, which was a chapter of the NRA that he called the Black Armed Guard. It consisted of at least 60 former soldiers, along with several women, including his wife, Mabel. Williams and the Black Armed Guard defended the home of a local black doctor who was targeted by the Klan, effectively chasing the Klan away and forcing the city ordinance, banning the Klan from the town. As he writes in his book, Negroes with Guns, about the racists who inflict violence against black people, they are most vicious and violent where they can practice violence with impunity. It has always been an accepted right of Americans, as the history of our Western states prove, that where the law is unable or unwilling to enforce order, the citizens can and must act in self-defense against lawless violence. Isaac Woodard was greeted at that stop in Batesburg, now Batesburg, Leesville, South Carolina. Unfortunately, it wasn't Big Rob or any other person who would see Isaac as a brother or even as another human being. It was Sheriff Linwood Shull. He was there to arrest Woodard, beat him with a blackjack, and gouge his eyes with it. Mr. Woodard making his way home from serving this country, laid in the Batesburg jail overnight, without medical treatment. Totally blind, he was taken again, still in uniform, to the city court where he was fined for drunken disorderly conduct. When he did eventually get to a VA hospital in Columbia, South Carolina, doctors determined there was nothing to be done to restore his vision. It said his story, which actor and filmmaker Orson Welles shared on his ABC radio show Orson Welles Commentary, helped move the Justice Department to call for action. When it comes to violence perpetrated against black people, let the record show that the systematic response reveals that's just not for everyone. It only took the jury 30 minutes of deliberation to find the sheriff not guilty on all charges. Meanwhile, he admitted that he had blinded Uncle Zeke, or rather, Mr. Woodard. It said upon hearing the verdict, the courtroom broke into applause. That's a room full of people who could never see Isaac Woodard as a man, a veteran who served his country to protect their freedom. I could have met Mr. Woodard. We lived in the same town. See, after the trial, he traveled with his two sisters to reunite with his family, who moved north as part of that great migration of black Southerners seeking opportunity in the North. They moved to New York City, specifically the Bronx. Isaac Woodard died at 73 years old in the VA Administration Hospital in the Bronx on September 23, 1992. My dad was in and out of the VA hospital in the Bronx for years, beginning in 1989 during his time with Parkinson's. Isaac Woodard was buried with military honors at the Carrollton National Cemetery in Carrollton, New York. Buried with honor? In this country, black leaders, those who confront injustice and fight for freedom, are hated while they're alive and among us. After their death, they're celebrated, honored, and often quoted by those who hated them. This past MLK Day, we watched as the same politicians who actively worked to eliminate voter rights and support the homegrown terrorists who tried to take the Capitol simultaneously honor Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
It didn't cost the nation one penny to guarantee the right to vote. And a lot of people really supported us in Alabama and Mississippi and all across the South because they were really against something, not because they were for genuine equality for the black man. They looked at Bull Connor and saw how he was beating us and how brutal he was, and they were really outraged. They looked at Jim Clark and Selma, and they were outraged about it. And so they took a stand for decency. But it was never really a stand for genuine equality for the black man. T.S. Eliot said on one occasion that that is no greater heresy than to do the right thing for the wrong reason. A lot of people were doing the right thing, but they were doing it for the wrong reason. And now when we demand that people do the right thing for the right reason, they begin making excuses and giving all kinds of rationalizations. Now the time has come for genuine equality to come into being for all of God's children.
Y'all should really keep his name out your mouth and be true to who you are. Diabolical. Some who may listen to this episode may wonder, what in the world does this have to do with blindness or disability? Then they find out Uncle Zeke, too, was blind. He, too, was disabled. Isaac Woodard could have been a member of the ACB or NFB, another member of the local chapter of the XYZ organization. Perhaps someone who joined a monthly support group meeting. Would they have known who he was or what was done to him? Would they have spoken to him? Is his experience a blindness-related issue that warrants their organization's attention? Black History Month is an opportunity to reconcile with the past. A time to begin the process of figuring out how to do better. A time to celebrate the rich history of black people that didn't start with slavery. It started way before that. Before any other people's history. That's not in any way a flex or some sort of statement of superiority. It's a fact. My Black History mashup isn't as much of a rewrite of history, but rather a draft of the future. It doesn't have to end with physical violence. Everyone makes it home safely to just live their lives. That shouldn't be much to ask for, should it? Here's another win for the Read My Mind Radio family. 3 seasons of Read My Mind Radio are planned for 2022. I've lined up some awesome guests, and I'm talking to some more for later in the year. We're starting with what I always believe is the core of this podcast, the stories of compelling people impacted by blindness and disability. Season 1 this year is called Doing Your Thing With Disability. That's heavy emphasis on the with. When I wake up, I'm blind. When I'm working on this podcast, I'm blind. When folks enjoy and appreciate the results of that work, I'm still blind. Everything I do it blind or with my disability. I'm not overcoming it. I'm not getting around or over it. It's here with me all day and night. This first season, you'll get some dope examples of people just doing their thing with disability. Season 2, we're going to re-up on the flip. We're lining up some episodes to expand on these conversations about AD. You know what it is. Flipping the script on audio description. Because it's about more than entertainment. Season 3, we got YGBD. That's Young, Gifted, Black, and Disabled.
And yes, there's some fire here headed your way to close out the year. Between seasons, I want to either try some ideas out or share some opinions. That's why I hope you follow and subscribe to the podcast. It's the best way to make sure you don't miss out. I'm excited for 2022, and that's one thing I hope is infectious. If so, can you help me spread it? There's a lot of people who I think can help benefit from what we have. I believe it. I've been told this from many of y'all. It's the power of people. It's more about their stories than anything else. I just make blindness and disability sound funky. Peace.